My name's John Robbins, and these are the tracks that changed my life. So first off, Misshapes by Pulp, which I got into Pulp when I was about 14, 15, and Misshapes was the first single I bought that wasn't Pato Banton's Bubbling Hot. So I went to see them. The first ever live gig I saw was Pulp at the Birmingham NEC in 1996. And that was on His and Hers tour, but Different Class was just such a like big deal for me, because until then I'd only really been into Queen. So to have someone current who was on Top of the Pops and on the radio that I liked was quite special. The second song I've chosen is Romeo Had Juliet by Lou Reed. The first time I heard Lou Reed had a big impression on me, because I felt like he was like speaking directly to me, not because of what necessarily he was talking about, but like the way the albums are mixed and the way he sort of speaks. New York was the first Lou Reed album I got. And what was amazing, he was talking about like social issues and like quite gritty stuff, like street stuff from New York, which is a, you know, 16-year-old growing up in a market town just outside Bristol was just this amazing other world. And yet that he also had melody and really cool riffs and it was really rocky, but he was talking about poverty and drugs and addiction and like prostitution, which was quite a lot for my brain to get around. And then I sort of went through all of Lou Reed's solo catalogue, but I'll always remember Romeo Had Juliet for the lyrics and the sort of the poetry of the lyrics. It's quite exceptional. And Romeo wanted Juliet, and Juliet wanted Romeo. And Romeo wanted My third Juliet. Track is a sort of 12-minute instrumental-ish around that time, and it's by Godspeed You Black Emperor. The track on that was called Dead Flag Blues. And it was a very ominous spoken word track about like some post-apocalyptic scenario with these beautiful strings underneath. It was this like rock symphony makes it sound terrible. It makes it sound like a crap sort of prog track, but it is sort of cello and violins, bass, guitar and drums. And it just slowly builds and builds and builds and builds and then just explodes in this most sort of glorious crescendo. And I went to see them at the Fleece and Firkin in Bristol. There were maybe 100 people there, and it was just one of the most intense musical experiences of my life. The next song is Joe's Garage, and that's by Frank Zappa. And I first came across Frank Zappa when I was getting into Lou Reed's more sort of mid-70s stuff like Rock and Roll Animal and starting to dress like him and wear a leather jacket and ripped jeans and a studded leather dog collar and black nail varnish. Because I just wanted to look like Lou Reed off the front cover of Rock and Roll Animal. And someone, I went into school, my friend Joe said, if you like Rock and Roll Animal, you're really gonna love Frank Zappa. And I'd never really didn't know much about Frank Zappa. I'd heard of the name, and he played me a song, and it was just, it was like there was melody and there was cool riffs. And so I went out and got the cheapest Frank Zappa CD I could get, which was called Cheap Thrills. And it was like every song was written by a different person, the totally different sort of genres, but there was something like connecting them. And the reason I've picked Joe's Garage from that, so it's a live version of Joe's Garage from one of the You Can't Do That On Stage Anymore live albums, but also released on Cheap Thrills, is that the band were laughing all the way through and making little jokes. The diamond is the hardest substance known to man, but you can't prove it because it's not a stupid name. That's because we did up for a couple of months that we was on a... And I didn't know the jokes. And it was like meeting a group of friends where you think, they're really funny, but what are they talking about? And I never heard people laugh whilst playing music before. And that's sort of what Frank Zappa means to me, is so funny. Hey,
garage. We didn't have no dope for LSD, but a couple of...
My next song is I See a Darkness by Bonnie Prince Billy. I first heard I See a Darkness in my car, an old Mini I had, and I picked up my friend Robin, and he put it on. And again, you know, I was discovering it totally organically. And I listened to it, and I didn't really latch onto it, and then I bought the album. And it just was such a revelation to me. I've since seen the man live, I think 15 times. I've got all his, everything he's put out, and he's sort of been my most constant musical comrade, I would say. I've met him a couple of times very briefly, like for a photo to say hello. And I See a Darkness at first listen is very, very depressing, but actually it's a song about hope. I think he's the best lyricist of my lifetime, certainly. And that I see a darkness, and that I see a darkness, and that I see a darkness. My final song is by Van Morrison, grumpy live performer though he is. But Astral Weeks is my favourite album of all time. And will always be. It will never be usurped from that position. It's just that's how it's going to be. And I didn't like it at first. And I listened to it again in the car and I was thinking, well, you know, the way Young Lovers do is quite good. And then maybe the sixth or seventh time I listened to it, it just all clicked. And I think the secret to that was getting past Beside You, which is at first quite a difficult song to listen to, but it's just pure poetry. And I wouldn't say that about many musicians, really, I don't think. And from that moment onwards, I began a relationship with Astral Weeks that I've had ever since. And it would be the last album on earth I listened to. If I was gonna die, I'd put it on. And I would commend everyone to not just get it, but to give it some time, even if it takes a couple of years, because it's really worth the wait. Every scrapbook stuck with glue, and I'll stand beside you. Radio.